All right, welcome. Welcome to our How to Solve Hip and Knee Pain Workshop. I'm so happy to have you guys here, both online and in person. And just the more trips around the sun that I take, the more I realize how precious time is. And so I just want to say I really appreciate you, all of you, taking the time to actually be here, to hear what we have to say. And I know that it's going to be worth your time. I'm really excited to share some things with you guys. One of the things that makes me really sad is when someone tells me that they've been told that their joint, whether it's their knee, their shoulder, their back, or their hip, is bone on bone. Because I kind of wish that doctors wouldn't say that to people. Because it seems so scary. And oftentimes people think that now that means that they're always going to have pain or that they definitely need surgery. And the reality is that you can literally be, you know, have your cartilage be so degenerated that it looks like it's bone on bone. And you can still, it is possible for some people to avoid surgery. They need to be willing to put in some effort on their part to do the proper things to rejuvenate their joint, but it can be rejuvenated without surgery really often. And we see that here in the clinic, and that makes me happy. I get to see that happen, helping people that have been told that they need surgery, that they can actually prevent that surgery. The other thing that happens a lot of times is people will be told, like for their knee, that they have a meniscus tear and that they need surgery. And the truth is that they've done research where they take a group of people, all of them surgical candidates for a meniscus tear in their knee or a labral tear in their hip. What they found is that for the majority of people, if they do 3 months of proper therapy, they can avoid surgery. And the outcome a year later is the same as the people that did surgery. And the thing that people don't know or realize is that if they do surgery, they're gonna need 3 months of rehab. So if you do surgery, you still have to do the therapy. And so it's not really emphasized, it's not really, they don't realize it. They think surgery is gonna be a quick fix. But any time that you have surgery on a joint, you're introducing trauma to that joint. And so it's a lot better to avoid surgery if you possibly can. And the thing that a lot of people don't realize is there's definitely ways to do that. So we're gonna talk about that today, and we're gonna also show you some things, and we're going to let you experience some things for yourself. So I'm really excited to when we get into that part of the talk. All right, so let's move to the next slide. So one thing that's really important to understand is that if you have pain in your knee or your hip, it is the victim, not the cause, almost always. And I can't tell you the number of times, it's like so many, that people will come in and they'll say, you know, I have this pain in my hip and I know it's the arthritis. You know, they've been told they have arthritis, or they just think that they have arthritis. And then we do some work to release their soft tissue and their pain goes away. I'm like, oh, how about that arthritis? Maybe it wasn't arthritis. It definitely wasn't arthritis, okay? You can have arthritis in a joint and not have pain. That's something that a lot of people don't realize, but we have actually scientific studies on this, that they've taken groups of people, none of them with pain. They've done MRIs, x-rays, and then they've found that these joints are degenerated. They can see all this arthritis in the joints. These people don't have pain. So why are we using x-rays and MRIs to explain pain? So when somebody goes in with pain in their hip, like it's a really common thing that people are like, we hear this all the time, where people will say, I'll ask them, when did your hip pain start? And they'll say, you know, it just kind of like gradually seemed to come on over time. Really, really common. And then it just got worse and worse to the point where now I'm limping, you know? And I wish that people would come when they start having hip pain, I wish that they would come right away to physical therapy, especially for the hip, because the hip, people can tend to like just work around hip pain for a long time. And the problem with doing that is that you just adapt to that pain, so you just do less and less, right? Or you kind of push through the pain. Either way is not good. And if people would come to see us or see a specialist that knows how to take care of hips and knees properly, right when the pain starts, then it's not gonna continue to degenerate the joint. Because usually, if they come early, it's a simple fix. It's like 2 or 3 sessions. But if they keep trying to push through it, which I would do that too if I didn't know, if they just keep trying to push through, hoping it's gonna go away, hoping if I put a cream on it, or hoping if, you know, I take some pills, it's gonna go away. If they keep pushing through it, then what happens is it wears the joint out more, and it just ends up making it worse because the tissue tightens around because of the pain. So if you have pain right now, it's important to do something about it. And we're gonna help you kind of learn some things to do today, which is awesome. All right, that's what this is all about. Okay, so here are some common causes of hip pain, all right? You have a bursa right here on the outside of your hip, and it is supposed to be your cushion for your hip joint. When people have pain right on the outside here, a lot of times that's a bursitis, which is a fancy, you know, medical term for irritation or inflammation of the bursa, right? And one of the best ways to take care of that is releasing the soft tissue around the area, because it's probably gotten stiff, and then strengthening. Because usually when things get stiff, it's because there's an imbalance in the muscles. So it's the proper kind of strengthening that needs to happen. And something a lot of people don't realize is that after the age of 50, something called sarcopenia occurs. So I'm sure that there's nobody over the age of 50 here in this workshop, but if there were, it would be important to understand that after the age of 50, sarcopenia happens, which means that your muscles are wasting away. All of your muscles. It's part of the aging process. It just happens. And the ones that aren't wasting away, the reason that they're not is because you're using them. Okay? And you have to be very intentional about which muscles you're using, how you're using them, how you're exercising in a preventative way to prevent problems from occurring in your joints after the age of 50. So that's why so many health problems start to happen after 50, because people haven't been taught you need to do these 4 exercises to keep your hips and your knees strong, which we're going to teach you today. You need to do these 2 stretches to keep the joint nice and loose. We're going to teach you that today. It's really important. And I just wish that I could shout this from the mountaintops and get it everywhere, put it like on national TV, because then people wouldn't be getting so many hip replacements and they wouldn't be getting so many knee replacements. It's completely unnecessary how much of that is going on. And so we're going to teach you the things that you need to do, but just understand that if you have pain out here, it's probably not the actual cause. You could take a pill to reduce the inflammation, it's going to keep coming back. The cause has to do with probably some weakness in your foot muscles, probably some weakness in some of your butt muscles, probably some weakness in some of your quad muscles and muscles on the inside of your leg. And why did that happen? Well, if you aren't intentionally training it, then it went bye-bye if you're after 50. And if you're younger than 50 and you're having problems, it could be because you had an injury that caused the muscle to freak out. Because when injuries happen, everything braces to protect you, and then the muscles don't necessarily automatically know how to turn back on after an injury. They have to be re-turned on. I don't know about the grammar on that, but you gotta turn them back on, and we will help you. We know how to get that turned back on. And if you don't work with an expert that knows how to turn the muscles back on after an injury, then they will stay sleepy forever. And your body will just compensate around it. So if you're young, if you're under 50, then it could be that you had an injury that's inhibiting muscles from working right, and we need to get that going again for you. If you're also young but over 50, then you probably have had some muscle wasting that's happened due to age and the aging process, and we can help you to reverse that and know how to maintain it. And then also, if you've had injuries, regardless of your age, the same thing happens. Muscles, you know, forget how to work right. They just need to be learned how to do it right again. All right? Sometimes I like to say things wrong because it's just fun for me. I don't know why. So any of these things, whether you've been told you have tendonitis or arthritis, if you've been told that you have osteoporosis, FAI is impingement in the hip. If you've been told you have that, or if you've told you have a labral tear, most of the time it can actually be solved with specialist physical therapy care. And if you've gone to physical therapists before for it and it didn't get better, then you probably didn't see a specialist. And that's what really sets us apart. The things we do here, literally no other clinic in Orange County is doing. And maybe someday that will change, but for now, we tend to be the place where people have gone and tried other things and then it didn't work, but they're looking for a solution. They want to avoid injections, they want to avoid medication, they want to avoid surgery. They find us and they get the solution that they're looking for. All right, next slide. So I kind of already talked about the root cause. One thing I do want to mention is this isn't really necessarily intuitive for people, but if you have hip pain, the hip and the lower back, they're like twins. If one hurts, the other hurts, okay? If you ever heard about that, you know, identical twins feeling the pain of the other one, they're just like that, okay? So it has to do with the way the nerves are oriented, and it has to do with the way the muscles all work together. But if you have a problem in your back, then it can cause hip pain and vice versa. So anytime someone comes in with back pain or hip pain, we are gonna look at their back. We're gonna look at their hip because they're so tight, all right? So that's important to understand. And one of the couple of things that we're doing here today are gonna address both issues. One little thing too, though, is that if you have a spinal segment that's stuck, then all this stuff that we're doing here today is gonna help, but we gotta get that segment unstuck. And what I'm talking about is usually only takes one session to get it unstuck. And so if you try this stuff at home, because you're gonna, in your cool little goodie bags, if you came here in the clinic, you have actually a handout that has, you can go to like a little QR code and scan it on your phone and it'll take you to a video. And you'll be able to watch the videos and practice the stuff we cover today. And if you're finding after you do this stuff for a few weeks and it seems like you're still having the same pain, then it might be that you really would want to just call us, have a consultation. We do free consultation and we'll help you to figure out why. Because it could be that there's something stuck that just needs to get unstuck so all this stuff will work for you. Okay? Tight hip capsule, we're going to teach you a stretch for that. And just working on stretching it is gonna be good. And if sometimes what happens with a tight hip capsule, so the way your hip is designed, you've got this ball, which is the top of your femur bone, and it rests inside of a really deep socket, okay? And when you bring your leg up like this, the ball is supposed to slide down. And there's soft tissue down here that allows for that to happen. It's called a capsule. It's what holds the ball inside the socket. Okay, and what happens over time is it can get really stiff, and it could be from an injury, it could be because of problems in your back, but the capsule itself can get really stiff, and then what happens is the bone can't slide down. It's bumping against something that's stiff, and so then what happens, because it can't slide down, it bumps up, all right? So then you get pinching in your hip or pain in the front of your hip. People will think it's arthritis, you know, and they'll go to the doctor, get an x-ray. The doctor's like, sure enough, you've got arthritis. Oh no, you're bone on bone. And then they're like, oh no, I need surgery. And actually, if they come see us, many times we can help them prevent it. Because all we do is we stretch out that tight hip capsule with some specialized kind of hands-on techniques, get it loose again. Now it can slide. Now it's not bumping up against the bone, causing that irritation. So that's an example. It's such a simple fix, and I wish when people started having hip pain that they would just come to a specialist right away, just come for a few sessions, get it fixed, and then they won't need surgery. Because once you get it fixed, then you learn how to keep it maintained, you're gonna have healthy hips. So we're gonna go over one stretch, number one stretch for healthy hips. We're gonna go over that today, and I recommend you do it every day for the rest of your life to prevent having to need hip surgery, okay? All right, so let's go to the next slide. Dr. Winters is gonna talk about knees.
Awesome.
So welcome, Dr. Winters.
Hello.
Nicole, grab the microphone.
Oh yeah. All right, so moving on to our knee joint. So the knee is an interesting area, right? It sits between two very complex and dynamic areas of our body, so our foot and our hip. These are some common knee ailments that, raise your hand if you yourself have had one of these or know someone who has had one of these, right? We all do. Knee issues are very common. But again, going back to that idea that these issues are the victim, not the cause, right? So it's very rare that the one area where something has happened is the exact cause of pain. That might happen with like blunt trauma from a fracture, right? There's not really preventing that. But most other things, the fact that the tissue gets injured because it couldn't handle the load that was put on it is an issue somewhere up or down the chain in relation to the knee. Even if I'm playing soccer and I twist weird, you're like, okay, well, that's kind of a trauma and now I tore a ligament. Why couldn't that ligament withstand that force, right? And so a lot of, like Nicole was saying, targeted strengthening and myofascial release and stretching is what helps prevent some of those injuries. So it's very important. So we can go on to the next slide here. So I want to go into one of the main syndromes that we see at the knee and kind of knee pain causes that Nicole and I see in clients and patients and friends and family that are around us. And it's called patellofemoral pain syndrome, which is just a very fancy name for pain in the front of your knee. So I'm going to give an example. So we have Bob. Bob loves to ski. He loves to surf. He loves to snowboard. He is all about fitness, right? So Bob walks around like this, but he's really active, right? And all of a sudden one day, Bob has some knee pain right here. Just came on, right? So Bob does some research, contacts Dr. Google, and he says, well, right there, you know, that's where my medial meniscus is. And so maybe I have a meniscal injury, and you know, the pain's not going away, it's just staying there, maybe it's getting worse. So Bob goes to his doctor, and Bob gets an MRI. And the doctor says, you know what, Bob, you got lots of tears in that medial meniscus, got some arthritis going on, you need surgery. And Bob says, oh man. So then Bob finds us and he comes to see Nicole and I. We say, Bob, you're using your quads all day long. You're really tight in these quads and hip flexors, Bob. And your foot, you know, Bob, you kind of let that foot collapse in when you walk. And we need to strengthen these muscles here, Bob. We need to do some muscle releases here. And we get Bob better. And Bob has no pain. He's back to all of his activities. And he didn't need surgery. But if he went back and got another MRI, Bob's still gonna have those meniscal tears. Meniscus, it's a very avascular area, so what that means is it just doesn't get a lot of blood flow. So the potential to heal the tears is not that high, but for him to not have pain is there. We see it all the time. Mm-hmm. We help people with that all the time. So these are some of those common causes for that anterior knee pain, right? So he would fall into that category. Maybe you have just global pain all around the knee and it's like, I'm of a certain age, maybe I have arthritis, but like Nicole was saying, tons of people have arthritis. We consider now in the healthcare world, arthritis is our wrinkles on the inside. And are wrinkles painful? No, maybe to our ego, but otherwise they are not painful. So, you know, arthritis isn't meant to be painful, but what happens is we start to get into these movement patterns, right? Our brain wants to use the least amount of energy on things that we do every day, like walking and our sports that we're used to and these same exercises that we do all the time. It wants to use not a lot of energy because the brain has a lot of other things to focus on, right? So it's gonna start to strengthen some of those patterns that we do all the time, and that reinforces muscle imbalances. And sometimes that's hard to see. Even, you know, we have very educated clients. They're very healthy. They do a lot. They look up a lot. They know a lot about their body, but sometimes it takes expert eyes, right? So I was exaggerating Bob's case, but sometimes people don't realize that they're not getting into that hip extension and using their glutes. They don't realize that they're not rolling over their big toe and really activating all those muscles in the feet, which is super important for knee health. So if we go to the next slide, mirroring some of those causes of patellofemoral pain syndrome are root causes of most of our knee pain. I want to touch really specifically on foot and ankle stability, right? So our foot is a very complex area. It has 26 bones, 33 joints, and over 100 muscles, ligaments, and tendons in one foot. Yeah, that is a lot going on. And what do we do with that foot? We put it in a dark coffin where we can't move for our whole entire life. And then 80 years later, we walk around and we have horrible balance and we fall. And we say, why did that happen? Right? So our feet are meant to give our brain feedback about where we are in space. They're meant to be mobile and active. And it just doesn't happen in our shoes. But I definitely recognize that there is a whole cultural factor to shoes, right? We've worn shoes for ages. You wear heels to your wedding. That's part of our culture, right? You wear loafers to your job interview, and if you went barefoot, you probably wouldn't get the job unless they were really into health and open, maybe. Maybe in Southern California it would fly, but most places not so much. So, you know, we have to find that balance between cultural norms, abiding by that, but then also recognizing that our feet play a huge factor in health all the way up the chain, even in the back, right? So making sure that our feet are strong and healthy is very important. And another way to do that is with the technology that is on our next slide. So our barefoot science insoles, we all, again, know someone, maybe ourselves, that use orthotics, right? Normal orthotics, yeah, on the market, they can help, right? They can offload the system. But why does that happen, right? They're a Band-Aid. And, you know, I've prescribed them before for someone who has to be on their feet all day and they're in so much pain and we need to just let them, you know, do their job. But you still have to fix those root causes, which orthotics do not do. They give you more support. They turn off all those muscles in your feet even more. They reinforce just stiffness there, right? Because it's just this big support system, right? So barefoot science insoles, they're really cool. So what they actually do is you progress through these different levels of instability. So you're putting each one of those inserts in at different times once your foot starts to adapt. And what it does is it creates an unstable surface that you walk on every day. So you put them in your shoes. And now you're strengthening all those little muscles in your feet. It's giving you feedback to your brain about where you are in space and how you're moving. So they're incredible. If you want more information, we have information on them. You can also just Google that name, barefoot science insoles. And then of course, back to feet, right? We wanna do, and a lot of our exercises and balance work barefoot. And we wanna try and walk barefoot as much as we can before it's too painful to do that, which we see a lot as well, right? It's like, how do we get there? And luckily in Southern California, we have more opportunities to do that than probably most of the people in the world. So we should take advantage, right? And so I'm going to show you an exercise today where we're in standing, and we absolutely want to do those things barefoot. So anything you're doing at home, barefoot is the key to keeping those foot muscles strong and giving your brain good feedback to help your knee and hip pain.
Yeah.
Woo.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right, so I have barefoot science insoles in my shoes right now. I wear them whenever I'm wearing shoes, and I was born. So how many of you guys have heard of flat feet? Flat feet. Type into the chat if you've heard of flat feet. Yes. Okay. So I was born with flat feet. Now there's some people that have like Fred Flintstone for flat feet, where it's just like a pancake, right? And then mine happen to be flexible flat feet. Yeah. So. Can you see what she said? Because I can't read the whole thing. The point is that even if you have super flat feet, or if you have feet like mine that kind of like aren't sure which one they're going to be, these insoles, what I found for me is my feet used to hurt a lot. If I had to be on my feet a lot, my feet would hurt, my back would hurt. And I also had like a really sleep glute and hamstring on this side from an old injury. It was just sleepy. Of course, I didn't have the newbie, which is we're going to cover later, which the newbie will like massively wake up your muscles and nerves. But what I discovered from the technology of Barefoot Science, I put those in and I noticed that when I worked out, my right leg was sore and my left leg wasn't. Like, I did my normal workout after I put these in, and I'm like, oh dang, these things are actually stimulating the muscles of my right leg. And like in a way that it wasn't happening before. And they've actually shown that in research studies. They've been able to measure it, that people wearing these insoles, it actually activates, it strengthens the muscles of your butt and your hamstrings and all the muscles of your feet. So, hello! Why wouldn't I have these? Because it's actually just walking around, I'm getting stronger. It's so easy. So it's really a game changer having these insoles. And I've noticed not having the achy back, not having the foot pain with prolonged standing after getting these. And that's what our clients find too. Especially people that, like a grocery store clerk or a waitress, they love these things. They're really great. So anyways.
Marissa's recommend having a back to school sale right now. So.
Oh, yeah. So somebody online, she said they're having a back to school sale. So get them now. I would recommend for most people, the Therapeutic Plus. Most people are going to do best with that. Unless you have really flat feet, then maybe go with the active ones. All right. So common exercises. And then we're gonna have you guys start doing some stuff for yourself. So these are some common exercises you've probably done or you've seen someone doing in the gym. All right, for strengthening your hips, your legs, your knees, all that. And this one right here, I wanted to point out, this little back compression machine, I would recommend never getting on. So if you see the leg press and it's oriented like that, where you're all crunched up and you're super crunched up and you're like, you know, your feet are over your head, it's compressing your spine so much. There's so many better options. Look for a leg press that's not quite like that, or do a different exercise. We're gonna give you an exercise today to do. Now, one thing I wanted to point out too, is you can see all these exercises on these pictures. They're all good exercises. It's really important that you do them properly. And that's the thing that we see a lot of times. I say this all the time. It's super crucial for your health that you're doing the right exercise the correct way. Because if you're doing the right exercise, but it's incorrect, your technique, then you're going to get injured. You're going to have problems. And so a lot of times when people say that they have pain after going to the gym or working out in a fitness class, we're looking for, well, possibly they might actually just be doing the exercise incorrectly. So we'll work with them on that. And we have these group exercise classes that we teach. So it's an easy way for people to come in and actually learn from us how to do exercises correctly. Because even if you're watching, it's so common, really popular right now to do stuff where you just buy a program and do it, like, you know, on demand, which is great, but if you're doing it incorrectly, then you could be hurting yourself. So we have the classes online, we have them in person, and I just love that we do this for people because it really makes a difference in people's lives. The other thing is if you're doing things double leg all the time, double limb all the time, then what that allows to have happen is if you have, like I did, if you have one side that feels weaker or stronger than the other, so I want to take a poll right now, type into the chat or raise your hand if you know that you have one side of your body is weaker than the other side. Or you've heard of that happening to people. Okay, cool. Yeah, so if you're aware of it, right? Yes, right? So if you're aware of it, then great. And you might actually have a weaker side and not even be aware of it, right? Because it's so common, like 95% of people, that's the case, that one side's a little stronger than the other. So anytime you're doing something double limb, what's gonna happen is the stronger side is gonna be like, I got you, to the weaker side, and it's gonna take care of the weaker side, all right? So the weaker side is gonna stay weaker. And what happens with that is, this gets into a bunch of physics and, you know, biomechanics, but if you've got a weaker side, then what happens is the stronger side will take over, and the stronger side will tend to get a little stiffer, and it'll actually cause kind of a twist in your body. And imagine if I'm in a twist, like I'm like this, right? But then I'm trying to load it. okay? Can you see how that would cause a pinch in my back or my hip on this side, right? So we want to undo that twist. And we have lots of ways to do that, using soft rollers, using soft balls. Vibration is really, really great. If you do not have a joint replacement already or surgical implant of any kind already, vibration is wonderful. It actually helps to stimulate rejuvenation factors inside your joint to rejuvenate your joints. So I recommend using vibration 3 times a week, at least. I literally do it every day. There's really good ways to do it. We have all kinds of tips. If you want to learn how to do vibration properly for your health, then ask for our free report and we'll be happy to give it to you to help get you started in the right direction on how to do that correct. Because you can also do it incorrectly and you can cause problems to yourself. So the other thing too is to release that soft tissue. You can use cups, which we have instructions on our YouTube channel how to do that. You can use handheld vibration tools and this little ball and then like a stick, but you need to know how to use it correctly. So we have, you know, videos on YouTube how to do that. So let's say we release all of that stiffness that's been caused by that torsion. Well, if we're always just training double limb, it's gonna come back, okay? So it's really important. I'm not saying don't train double limb, that's good. It's okay to do. And it's even good to do, but we also wanna do, next slide, the stuff we're gonna teach you guys now, which is single limb stuff, a lot of single limb stuff, so that we're not reinforcing our imbalances. You guys are gonna find it. You're gonna find where you're weaker when we do these exercises. The weak side won't be able to hide. All right, so we're gonna say goodbye to the live stream. We've been live streaming on Facebook and Instagram. And we're gonna say bye to you guys for now so we can focus on the people that are in the workshop and help them to learn this stuff. But check in for another workshop another time and maybe come to a workshop so you can get the tips, the hands-on stuff. Thanks for watching. Okay, so let's start with taking care of our knee. So in your goodie bag, you guys have